Welcome to Sacramento Film Works, where we bring to you all things film. I'm Craig DeLuz.
And I'm Amy Henry. We're going to be talking about the making of a documentary. This is going to be exciting. We've got some great folks. Hang on. We'll be right back. Well, welcome back. We've got a special lady here. She is a director of the Theatrical Arts Ministry of Calvary Christian Center in Sacramento. And the name has been shortened to TAM, so we'll reference that often. But please welcome Miss Lorraine Feltes to the show with me. Thanks so much for being here, Lorraine.
Thank you for having me.
This is great. So, you are the director of the Theatrical Arts Ministry at Calvary Christian Center. So, tell me a little bit about yourself. How long have you been the director there?
About 10 years, 10 and a half years.
But you didn't start out as a director, and I think this is really great for you all to know. What did you start out doing in the entertaining field?
Well, I was just a part of the theater arts ministry, just doing the acting, and we'd have multicultural Sunday and waving a flag, but just the acting, I just love acting.
And then was there like a need for a director at that point? Did the theatrical arts group grow and they needed someone and you saw that this might be a love that I have that I can do? How did that work out?
I believe the directors that were there end up leaving and going out of state.
Okay.
And the pastor just called me in and said, I can't see anyone else but you.
Oh, what do you do then? I'll step out.
But I have a passion for it, so I just stepped up to the plate. And
wow, that's awesome. So let's talk a little bit about what the productions have been, because from what I understand, it over the last 10 years, it's really grown. So now you guys are doing full-on stage productions, and there's another component that we're going to talk about in just a few minutes that's going to be really exciting, which sets them apart. But tell me a little bit about the production you just got finished doing.
That was something different for me. I teamed up with the choir director, and it was a musical called More Than Just a Man. And it was a story of Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea.
Okay.
The story of Jesus through them. And
wow,
that was pretty exciting.
So it was an Easter.
It was Easter.
Mm-hmm. So is this a production that's going to run next year as well?
Yeah, we definitely got to do it again next year.
Okay, so the attendance was real good and the response was really good.
Mm-hmm, and we learned a lot.
She says with a smile. What about the upcoming production? Because you and I had a chance to talk about, I'm really excited about, tell our audience about what's coming up.
We've got, it's called Before It's Too Late. Mm. And that's going to be October.
Okay.
And that's a story we do on hell.
Okay.
It is October, so you know, instead of people going out to haunted houses, come to church and see what we do.
Wow. And so I know you brought us a clip, and we're going to go to that in just a few minutes. It's not quite a clip about that production, but another production that you guys did about this kind of a hell series. The topic was about hell as well. What was that one called?
It was called Oh Hell No.
Oh, okay. I bet you that raised a lot of eyebrows.
A revelation of hell. Yes.
Oh, really?
It was.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're going to take just a quick minute and look at the clip that you brought, and then we'll come back.
Okay.
All right, let's take a look.
And in tonight's Faith Matters, what to do with Halloween? There are a lot of churches that say it's derived from a pagan holiday and no one should be celebrating it.
But as Rick Boone reports, some churches have decided to mix heaven and hell to spread a different message.
Believe it or not, those screams are sounds of praise. It's Calvary's fourth year of their theatrical play that takes you on a journey to hell. But there's a lesson here, as Calvary has actually seen a bump in members all thanks to their hell play. It seems the devil is good business for boosting church service. Calvary will keep on screaming, at least for the next few days, all in hopes of creating more angels on earth.
Okay, so am I mistaken, or was that you just running across the stage?
That was me running up to the stage.
So yeah. This one, you actually had an opportunity to do both acting and directing.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. That's pretty awesome. That was amazing. And it had the dancers in there as well. That is really good. Now, but that leads me into talking about the uniqueness of your productions. Now, I know that these productions are not just your average production. Let's talk about the interaction and the multimedia aspect of how these are different.
Yeah. The way I like to invite people, I say it's like coming to see a movie, and then the movie comes alive on stage.
Okay, so for our viewers, picture that for me. I'm coming to the production, and I get a chance to see what's happening. Something's on screen at first.
Mm-hmm. You see okay. The silver screen,
okay.
And all of a sudden those people appear on stage acting.
That is really interesting. That is a very unique approach. Was that your approach as a director to write it that way?
Well, we have a team. I have a team. It's not just me.
Well, I really wish you the best. This has been really good to be able to highlight what the church is doing and what you're doing. And 10 years says a lot. And so congratulations. Thank you again for being here.
Thank you for having
me. We really appreciate
it.
You're welcome. And that is it. Thank you. We'll be right back.
Welcome back, everybody. Today we're going to be talking about the making of a documentary. Now, my memory of documentaries when I was a kid was remember the Wild Kingdom growing up, and it was the thing that always came on after the cartoons. So I was like, I went from
so
interest level this to interest level this. But you know, I found that now documentaries have changed.
They have really, really changed. I mean, you know, I've worked with PBS a lot, and they are now exciting. They're engaging. I mean, my son sits with me at age 10, and we'll sit and watch a documentary. And I think because they have made it so engaging.
Right.
And so I'm excited about the show today because we're going to talk about that.
Right. So today we have with us the makers of a groundbreaking documentary. We have Frazier Kershaw and Doug Clevenger.
Yes.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much
for being here.
Thank you.
You guys have just flown in from El Salvador.
Yeah.
And you still look great. You don't look too tired, so that's great.
Well, if we can pull that off with no sleep, then we'll
be good. Right. Yeah. Well, good. We're going to talk some more about just the making of the documentary. So even if you could take us from the starting block, almost the ABCs of it.
Before we do, how did you guys get into film? I mean, that's one of the things we always like to ask our guests is what got you into film? And I guess in this case, particularly a documentary.
Well, for me, full disclosure, Wild Kingdom, I loved it. Mm. I absolutely loved that show. So, that was, you know, just I actually went to film school and was studying narrative film and then had the opportunity to work with a colleague on a project about Cabrini Green in Chicago, and sort of fell in love with the idea that you can tell these real stories.
I was a fixer with a film crew in Latin America, where I would take the film crew and hook them up with the locals and the government, and have them work together. And I was always kind of off air. And then I worked with Halogen TV on a project about serving others. And so I just kind of combined both of them, and now I'm here, as sitting next to you.
Wow! And how long ago was that?
That was in 2008.
2008, mm-hmm. And for you, Doug?
Oh, it's been a little while.
Yeah. You've got a history.
Yeah, I finished school in 93, 94.
Wow. Yeah. And you've worked with the Discovery Channel, with PBS, with the Travel Channel, and just the list, National Geographic, mm-hmm. The list just goes on. So how did you find each other?
You know, it's... I'm very fortunate because I've worked with so many different types of people in the bush. literally within, 10 to 15 people that I've worked with, it wasn't clicking because you're in such a hard area to work in. You know, it's 100 degrees, there's no protection in terms of shade. There's bugs, there's kind of dangers and things. And once I looked up him and we saw each other and we kind of had similar backgrounds, and I kind of need him, and hopefully he needs me, so we can really make a difference when we're out there shooting in the third world.
Wow. So now, tell us about your current project, Waterworks. What inspired it?
I've been working with my mother in Latin America for the last 20 some years, and she used to bring down medical supplies and medical teams, doctors, optometrists, and she would treat all the people that have never seen a doctor, and. There were a lot of them had the same kind of illnesses, and we never kind of really knew at that time in the 80s and 90s. But then recently, technology and new information came out that all of the illnesses are water related.
Really?
Wow.
So, and that's 1 billion people on Earth. 7 billion people on the planet, 1 billion don't have access to the water.
Right. Right here, so yeah. I would imagine, correct me if I'm wrong, but with that number of people, the higher percentage of those that are dying are probably children.
You got it. Under the age of 5. I think 6,000 die every day.
What?
Worldwide. So the power of water is probably the most important thing to humanity right now. It's a crisis. And you need to get a special kind of person like Doug to really get in there. And I can set up the framework, but then he's the guru that can really set up the shots. And he works well with the locals. He works well with all the different types of variables.
I'm glad you brought working together with the locals, because let's say there's folks, and there are, that are watching, and they're interested in doing something similar to what you're doing in another country. How does that work? I mean, do you have to go in knowing the language? Do you do your back work, like he and I do our back work when we're going to have guests on, but do you do your back work in regards to, you know, what's the culture? What's the language? Do I have to know the language? Especially when you're wanting to go in and film those folks, and then just getting the rights to do that. Mm-hmm. Talk to us a little bit about that process.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of setup work that happens, and that's what Fraser's particularly been just really terrific with, is creating that framework for this project.
Okay.
He does speak the language. I don't. We have an interpreter as well.
Oh, okay.
But you know, you go into different cultures, and I think the most important thing is just to learn a little bit about that culture and to show basic human respect. Mm-hmm. You know, treat them as you would anybody else.
Yeah.
You know,
okay.
They're not objects. You know, you're going in and you're visiting their world.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, and you're a guest, and so you just sort of act accordingly, I think.
Yeah. And have you found that they are, when you come in and you've got water, I mean, one of the most valuable assets, how do you get, what's the response?
So if there was a neighborhood that you lived in and I gave your house clean water and everyone knew that you had clean water, what would people do?
Run to my house.
Right.
And when you're trying to sleep at 2 o'clock in the morning and someone needs clean water, you might have to open the door, or you could shut it. Or if that's where the clean water is and you have 100 people in town and they all know where that is, and if they know that their family needs the clean water to survive, what are you going to do to go get it?
Right. You know, before we go, we want to make sure to give our audience a chance to see a brief clip from Waterworks. So could we go ahead and roll that clip for our studio audience?
That's great.
The water crisis claims more lives through disease than any war through guns. I'm not sure of a fairy tale ending on this one. This is a story about the people. Every day, 6,000 children die from water-related diseases. More than 1 billion people don't have access to clean water. This is unacceptable. We're starting our journey in El Salvador to see the problem firsthand.
God knows what is hiding in those weak and drunken hearts. Guess he kissed the girls and made them cry, those hard-faced queens of misadventure. God knows what is hiding in those weak and sunken eyes. Fiery throngs of muted angels giving love but getting nothing back. Oh, people, help the people. And if you're homesick, give me your hand and I'll hold it. Nothing will drag you down. Oh, and if I had to pray. Oh, and if I had to pray. A falling star fell from your heart and landed in my arms.
I want to find a way to bring clean water to everybody. People are dying, and we're running out of time. I'm Frazier. Let's deliver clean water to the people. There's 1 billion of them, and they want to tell you their story, and they're waiting for you. Follow us on our journey around the globe and watch the driving force reach the people. If you committed your life to giving people clean water, you can make your life count.
So, tell us about what we just saw.
Bathroom, shower, drinking water, animals and humans all in 15 feet hanging out. So, that's why there's a crisis. And, yeah, that's pretty much the big issue.
Wow.
Wow, that's amazing. Thank you for what you guys are doing. This is extremely, I don't even know how to put the right words to this. I mean, this is life-saving. What you're doing, and I can't begin to thank you for being on our show. And I know we're not done, but that tells the whole story right there.
Okay, well, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, Amy will be in the audience, who obviously has some questions for our industry experts. Yeah. So we'll be right back.
And welcome back. I'm with the studio audience, and they've got some wonderful questions that they're going to ask our industry experts. So let's start with the first question. Your name is?
Hi, I'm Casey.
And Casey, what question do you have?
My question is for Fraser. Wanted to know if you plan on going beyond documentary films.
I would be open to it if it had a really good purpose.
And your name is?
My name is Trudy, and the question is for Doug. Doug, how important is the chemistry between a cinematographer and a director?
It's a great question. It's extremely important. And I think that the scene that we looked at is a good example of that. We were in tight spaces. I think we stepped in the same heaping pile of cow dung. And we were in sync.
Yeah.
Wow. And your name, sir?
My name's Timothy, and my question is to both of you. In your opinion, what is the biggest difference between a documentary and a narrative film?
I think a documentary is more truthful rather than maybe, I mean, I believe that maybe the cinema is more staged.
And from my perspective, I think they're both creative processes. I think that a narrative film is additive. You're building it like an architect. And I think documentary is you're looking at the world through a particular lens, and you're taking away what you don't want to see, and you're focusing on something.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so if folks want to know more about Waterworks or the work that you're doing on this issue, how do they get a hold of you?
Good question. Google Waterworks Behind the Water.
Well, that's simple enough. Well, we want to thank you guys for coming out and for being a part of our show. Ladies and gentlemen, please give them a hand. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. Well, that's it for this episode. Sacramento Film Works is a project of the Northern California Filmmakers Coalition in partnership with Access Sacramento. We'd like to thank our spotlight guest, Lorraine Feltus, as well as our industry experts, Fraser Kershaw and Doug Clevenger. I'm Craig DeLuze.
And I'm Amy Henry. Thank you so much for being with us. This was a great show. I mean, I think you walked away knowing that there's more to a documentary than you thought, and it's really entertaining. So I'm really excited that you got to be with us today. So we get a chance to show you how film works because we are the Sacramento Film Works Show, where we show you
how film works.